Cashflow Diary Podcast, episode 346.
Welcome to yet another exciting episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast, the podcast that teaches you insider tips, tactics, and strategies for creating leveraged streams of cash flow into your life. Learn from top-performing entrepreneurs, business owners, investors, and thought leaders from across the globe as they share their secrets to success. Like what you learn on this and other Cashflow Diary podcast episodes? Go to learninvestingnow.com and sign up to receive powerful tips and information that will help you succeed as an entrepreneur and investor. Now, here's your host, investor, entrepreneur, business owner, educator, speaker, author, and master facilitator of Robert Kiyosaki's Cashflow Game, Jay Massey.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast. I'm your host, Jay Massey, and I'm glad that you're here today because, well, honestly, I'm going to say that this particular episode, it's kind of more for me than it is for you, and you guys get to come along with it. But realistically, I think we're all going to benefit because today's entrepreneur is actually out there solving problems that I know I have personally, and I'm certain a number of you who have ever been in the middle of a transaction, you have the problem too. So although I'm thinking about like my business right now in this particular episode, I'm guessing it's going to help your business tremendously as well. You're like, what on earth are you talking about, Jay? Well, have you ever thought about what it takes to actually close a deal? I think about it all the time. In fact, I schedule closings around my travel. For example, we can do just about everything virtually, except certain documents get really, really difficult if I leave the country. Why? Because we have things like notaries involved. Yes, other countries have different options, but what we need is a step up in technology. We need a step up in thinking, and we have an entrepreneur who is out there stepping it up to help us be able to close more deals with less friction. That's how I like to look at it. He is the CEO of Snapdocs, and I am talking about none other than Aaron King. Now, what's interesting to think about is that he's been involved in real estate for a number of years. And what I like about that is that he has a real estate background, but he took a break to actually learn to program. Like, okay, I'm done with real estate, so let's learn to program. And now he's merging these two worlds together so that title, escrow companies, etc., can have a fully digital process. That's his goal, a fully digital process for us being able to close deals. I'm excited because, man, that means I don't have to go down to the UPS store anymore. Let's find out what he's got to say. Help me welcome none other than Aaron King. Aaron, you there?
I'm here, Jay. Thanks for having me on your show.
Yeah. I'm glad you're here. I almost don't want to take you away from making this happen because I get these, you know, my staff, they'll send me over the email and they're like, okay, it's another notary. I'm like, great. I got to stop everything I'm doing, go all the way over there, sign the docs, come back. And I mean, yeah, I know it's first world problems, but it's still a problem.
Yeah. I think it's worth saying too, notaries, I mean, the idea of a notary is a pretty old system and there's better things we can be doing with technology. But a lot of these notaries are really important to the process. And if you get the right one, they're going to make everything go smoothly and, you know, ensure that this transaction that has so much work behind it is actually going to get closed properly.
Indeed. Now, this being your first time on the show, I have a question for you that I've got to ask because I ask everybody. So are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. So I tend to look at today's entrepreneurs a lot like yesterday's superheroes. So, you know, I don't know of a superhero that actually did any writing per se, but we had, Superman and Clark Kent. They have alter egos, et cetera. But you got Spider-Man and Batman and Wonder Woman. You got all of these superheroes. And I think entrepreneurs and superheroes have a ton of things in common. Chief among them in this case is that, you know, as an entrepreneur, we go out there, we develop and products and services to solve people's problems. And I think that's what superheroes do. They use their unique abilities to solve other people's problems. However, before the superhero was a superhero, he or she just was usually a normal person. So what we want to know is before the Aaron King that's before us today and actually removing our pain points with Snapdocs, etc., What we want to know is, well, who is Aaron King?
Sure. Yeah. So in terms of my path to starting Snapdocs, starting pretty early on, I had some pretty good mentors in my life. I think my mom started a sort of plant servicing business when I was probably 5 or 6. So I got to see that from a super young age.
Whoa. Hold on. You said mentors and then you said mom. Are you saying your mom is one of your mentors?
Yeah, absolutely.
No, well, that doesn't happen a lot. That's why I was just asking. I was like, I had good mentors and then you said my mom. I was like, oh, okay, cool. This is good. All right.
Yeah, I'd go back. She's probably the earliest mentor and probably true for, you know, a lot of people out there if you drill down far enough. But so she started the business. I had other people in my life running businesses. I started working from a really young age, which I think is really beneficial to entrepreneurs. Hmm. To kind of see different organizations and see how they're run. And, you know, I think I've a lot of people will look at management and look at how a company is run and think to themselves, I could probably do this, or I could probably even do this a little bit better or differently. And so a lot of my early ideas about running companies and, you know, what I was kind of planning to do with my life throughout my teenage years and then after high school all sort of added up to knowing that I was going to be sort of running companies for the rest of my life.
Mm. So there was a CEO program in your high school?
Not exactly. No, it was like after high school working every day. I mean, I worked all kinds of jobs growing up. I worked in an ice cream shop. I worked in an auto shop. I worked as a waiter. You know, I worked in offices. When I was a senior in high school, I started working for a mortgage company, answering phones and doing data entry and these types of things. But I think a big part of my education and sort of confidence in starting companies came from this early exposure to, you know, seeing how companies are run and sort of being able to see the internal mechanics and sort of even people's personalities and how that affected their ability to do their jobs. But it just, you develop sort of a view that these things are possible.
Got it. So it was the ability to see that it wasn't a foreign concept to actually just start something from your own head. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, exactly. Start it and run it. You know, even some of these companies that I was working for throughout my teenage years were, you know, had 200 to 300 people in them. And even with those larger companies, understanding how they're run and seeing that it's not that far away. It's not that impossible.
Got it. Totally understood. Well, that brings up something interesting, though. I know for a lot of would-be entrepreneurs, especially at the beginning, it seems like that, you know, it does seem far away. It seems like it's going to be this long journey before I have, quote unquote, my business up and running. Or why do you think it isn't?
I think a lot of that is mental. And I think a lot of the way people imagine starting a business involves a lot of capital and a lot of people and, you know, the journey of a thousand miles kind of thing. and it seems overwhelming, but the truth is you can prove out a lot of these things. If you have a thesis or you think you can do something well or bring some value to the world, there's a lot of ways of testing the water and doing this without a ton of risk or without a ton of, you know, negative consequence. And so I think, you know, to those people that feel like it's overwhelming or that it's too much, I'd say figure out a smaller piece you can break off and sort of try and experiment with. A lot of big companies, and even this company is a perfect example of that, started, you know, kind of learning to code and coding for a few hours after work every day until I had sort of proven that the world wanted this thing. Mm-hmm, and so mm-hmm. It's not like I needed to go out and get a bunch of investors and, you know, convince a bunch of people to work with me. And maybe some businesses do require that, but I'd say there's always somewhere easier you can start and sort of, you know, get familiar with the process and start to build something from small beginnings.
Now, there's something in this whole thing that I just want to bring out, because you just, all right, did you have any sort of electronics or engineering background that you're like, how do you even get to the point of going, because I've thought about making an app and I'm like, I've thought about trying, you know, electronics. And then I was like, coding. I'm like, you know what? Nah, I hire somebody to code. You go, no, I'll just learn it. How on earth do you make that jump? Like,
so it's a really good question. And I sort of started the way you did when I was running my last company, Notary Link, which was 2001 to 2008. Mm-hmm. I did hire contract developers to come in and build software for us for sort of internal use.
Okay.
But through that process, you know, I sort of learned a little bit of how to be a product manager and how to not fully manage engineers, but work with them and collaborate with them. towards the end of that company, I was actually in the code, making small changes, understanding the structure and how things work. So I sort of learned a little bit about it a while ago and saw the potential of what was possible. You know, you could write a small program or make some small changes and it could impact thousands of transactions or thousands of people's sort of daily work. And then when I started coding for Snapdocs, I really wanted to get good at it. So I started with a kind of base understanding. I knew what was possible and I just knew, you know, I really believe sort of everything in the world is turning into software. And I think people that build technical skills and have technical understandings are going to just have a leg up in the world to come, if not, you know, obviously today. And so I wanted to get technical and I wanted to learn to program. But I was self-taught. You know, there's lots of tutorials online.
Right.
Programming is one of these things that, you know, if you're somewhat autodidactic or really curious and you're okay with struggling, which is a big part of learning how to program is just like fighting through the hard parts. You know, it's something you can learn. And it's worth saying, I never got good at it. I was never a great programmer, but I was good enough to get, you know, the basic foundation in place and to get something up and running to where, you know, then people could join me and start doing it right.
Right. They're like, let us take over from here.
Okay. there's plenty of mistakes that had to be fixed afterwards. But I mean, it's just what it takes to get something off the ground. It doesn't need to be perfect, but it needs to be something.
Love that. I love that completely. Now, there's something that you just brought up that I know somebody like cringed in their car or in the treadmill while they were listening. You said that you had to be okay with struggling. I find that that's common regardless of industry, is that there's a certain level of comfort we choose as entrepreneurs to be okay with when it comes to being okay with struggling. Why would you say that that's a necessary component?
I would, for a couple of reasons. I'd say it's a necessary component specifically to learning how to write code and program, because there's so many moments where you're going to get so frustrated and so stuck and you'll spend hours on something and then you'll realize it's all because you didn't restart your server or do something really, really simple and basic. And you have to fight through those things if you're going to get good and progress. And a lot of people don't have the patience for it. But on another level, you know, we part of our company culture here at Snapdocs is that we believe struggle is good. And there's a lot of times where we'll build a product or we'll, you know, be trying to hire somebody for a specific position and it takes a while and it's not perfect and it's hard. And if we don't think it's good enough for the world or good enough for the company, then, you know, we just say we need to struggle with this a little bit longer. And it's not comfortable and it's not fun, but that's how you end up with good product.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Now, through this journey, so take us, because you mentioned, and because this is a very eclectic grouping of occupation, how do we go from ice cream to auto repair shop waiter? I mean, I'm just saying they're not exactly related. So I'm, you know, there's a thought process. Something happened. I'm looking for that moment where what I like to call that superhero moment where you go, I have something unique here that I could share with people and let's do that. What was that journey?
Yeah. You know, I think it comes from, and I don't know if I got this from, you know, the people around me or if it's just innate, but I never saw work as something necessary and unfun, even from I started working really young and I've been working pretty consistently ever since. Mm-hmm. I always thought it was a fun challenge. I always enjoyed doing different things. I think I was kind of the kid that people knew was, you know, always looking for work and jobs. And so we had a family friend that owned an auto shop and I worked there for a summer. You know, I always enjoyed making money. I always enjoyed sort of working with people. And I think all these different various experiences kind of added up to me when I was 21, you know, wanting to make some money and sort of, I just moved back to San Francisco and I was trying to decide what to do next. And I was like, oh, well, I'll start a company. I understand the mechanics of how this works. I think I could, you know, pick this specific part of the market and do really well with it. And it was just the accumulation of sort of the experience that I had and the mortgage industry experience specifically, because the last company I ran was also in the mortgage industry. It was an accumulation of those things. I wouldn't say it was a light bulb that went off. It was just like a slow progression of like, oh yeah, obviously I'm going to start a company at some time. Might as well be now.
Okay. All right. So let's work with that, because a lot of people have asked themselves, okay, now what? What do I do next? And, you know, they come to the realization that another job isn't isn't what they want. But you go, I'll start a company. While that's unique enough in and of itself, how did you get to this company? How did you get to this idea, this concept, and go, this is the one that we can, you know, solve? This is what we can do to go out there and bring some good to the world.
That's a really good question. And honestly, I didn't know that I was going to be going back into real estate and mortgage. You know, I left the industry for several years, and I worked in technical roles and just worked in other industries. And I was, you know, as I was getting more technical and learning to program, I started just doing research in mortgage to figure out, you know, what has changed in the past 6 years or so. What kind of innovation has there been? Everything and nothing, you know.
Like, right.
And it was, you know, it was interesting to see that a lot of mortgage closings and mortgage processing was being done the same way that it always had been done, even though very fundamental concepts of technology had sort of changed every other major industry that I'm exposed to. And so it was an opportunity. I just thought there was a great chance to build really good technology and build a great company. And you know, that didn't come right away either. I really started programming Snapdocs and building it. And it was sort of months in after building it where I was like, oh, actually, this is the thing that could be the company. You know, whereas prior to that, I was just building it for the sake of learning and for the sake of building something.
This is good. This is what I like about that specifically is oftentimes we might not even start something because we don't see the full vision of what it is or how it'll be used. You didn't even have that as the purpose. It was like, this is what I'm using to learn to code in my spare time for fun. And it came to you. It's a process that I like to say, go as far as you can see. And when you get there, then you will see further. So what was inefficient, or I'm assuming you saw inefficiencies in the mortgage closing or processing process that said, hey, this what I'm doing could solve this?
I think the first really big insight was that, you know, I was building the software as a SaaS product. Instead of using it to run my own company like I had done before, I was now building software that any company could use to make their own loan closings better. And there's value in the aggregation of data across many companies. So think about Yelp or Uber or any of these big companies that uses user reviews and data across many different transactions to evaluate and be sort of the system of record for whether or not a restaurant is good, or, you know, you should be working with a specific person. And so that was the first big light bulb is, oh, wow, if a whole bunch of companies are using this, it's actually better for every single company using it. And the bigger it gets, the better it is for everybody. And I think that is one of the fundamentals of a really good technology business, is something that gets better as it gets bigger.
Got it. Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Now, I guess the question, though, is, it seems, to some, it could seem like very, very narrow. Very, very, it's like, are there, you know, the natural question is, are there really that many people? Is there really that much business? Is there really, can I really like sustain myself on this idea, etc.? How did you come to understand the size or capacity for being able to actually, you know, fund something like this and actually have enough customers to make it work? You know, what's really interesting is that I hope that in this particular story, you're picking up the fact that success is not a straight line. In fact, there could be things that you've done 10, 20, 15, I don't know, yesterday, ago, where it'll be another 10, 15, 20 years before you really even understand why you're doing it, let alone how it's going to lead you to where you ultimately want to go. But the key ingredient is making sure that you are still open. That's right, open in your mind to change directions if need be. It's one of the most important skills of an entrepreneur is being able to change directions and taking what is thrown at you and, well, as they say, taking lemons and making lemonade. If you want some insight on how to do that, you know, take your lemons and make it lemonade. If you've ever asked yourself or said, you know what, I wish I had more money, more credit, more knowledge, more time, and then I could get my business started, and you want to understand, well, how I did it, feel free to pick up a copy of my book at cashflowdiary.com/free book. Again, that's cashflowdiary.com/free book. Name and email go in the box. And what we'll do is we'll send you a PDF copy. And for those of you who like the audio stuff, feel free to do the exact same thing at cashflowdiary.com/freebook. Put in your name and email address and we'll send you an offer for the audiobook at half price. Anyway, let's get back to this very interesting new product that I know you want to take advantage of. Let's go find out more.
That's a really good question. And I think it's something that companies should really evaluate kind of early on, at least if they're planning on dedicating the next, 10 to 20 years of their life, just sort of how I think about this company. But I mean, it's mortgage. It's sort of a pillar of the economy. There's plenty of money in the industry as a whole, which is, kind of a very generic and not
right
detailed way of looking at it. But as you drill down, you can say, okay, there's about, call it roughly 1 million mortgage transactions every month. Every single one of those requires a loan closing. Every single one of those requires a notary. So if I can make a few dollars off every transaction to start out with, that's enough to get a company up and off the ground. And if we can build features and tools that handle more of this process for our clients, then the sky's sort of the limit. It's not unreasonable to think that technology providers could make $100 per transaction or $200 per transaction. And when you're talking about the total addressable market that way, it becomes pretty attractive.
Okay. Now, so that we're clear, because you threw out a number there and somebody got, they probably fell off their chair. You said 1 million loan transactions a month. Is that U.S.?
That's U.S. national, yeah.
Okay, got it.
And it's a rough estimate, but it's sure. Somewhere in that ballpark.
Yeah, well, I'm sure it's still a larger number than what someone might have been thinking. Either way, because, in the back of their head, they're like, is this really that big of a deal? And the answer is, yeah, it is that big of a deal. That's really what I was trying to get at. It's like, yeah, this is a big deal. So then for those that may not have necessarily closed a transaction yet, and they may not understand the value proposition at this particular moment, what would you describe from your viewpoint, what is the normal way it's currently done and what's the way it should be done, with Snapdocs?
Yeah, this is a fun question. So anybody familiar with mortgage knows that it's a really complicated process, right? You're not just dealing with a bank. There's a lot of people involved in the transaction, from title and escrow to appraisers, inspectors, processors. There's probably easily 10 to 15 people involved in a mortgage transaction. And there are some technology platforms for specific parts of the transaction, but there's nothing that really ties the whole thing together.
Right.
And this is why a lot of consumers get really frustrated. If you ask them, hey, I heard you refinanced or bought a home recently. How was your experience? They'll express some frustration and often specifically around the loan closing, because they feel out of the loop. They feel like multiple people are asking them for the same information. They feel like things are delayed and they don't know why. And so, a big part of the future of mortgage is getting these systems to talk to each other or stringing together these different components so that they can all communicate more efficiently. And we're seeing that change in the mortgage industry now. Where Snapdocs comes in is we deal specifically with loan closings and specifically with the type of closing where a notary comes out to your house or to your office. So it's a convenience for the borrower so they don't have to drive down and take time out of their day to go to a title office.
Mm.
And what our platform does is it allows, we target specifically title and escrow companies, our clients, or these companies that manage loan closings, and their purpose in the transaction is just to manage the loan closing. And we plug in and we help those people find somebody that has a background check, that has experience, that has great reviews, and make sure they get out to the closing so that the borrower has a good experience. But our technology also ties into these other software platforms to let everybody know what's going on, so the loan mm-hmm. officer can be updated and know the closing's happening and, everything's sort of running on track, or so the title and escrow company can know what's going on. So just to summarize it, a lot of transactions today are still being done in a very non-technology way. The decisions aren't driven by data. They're not driven by API integrations that are just making things happen sort of across the industry. And what Snapdocs is doing, what the future of mortgage looks like, is all of these things are connected technologically and everybody's kept in the loop, and there's a lot more transparency that's going on to the companies involved, but also to the consumer.
Yeah. And I mean, it's a process that feels like hurry up and wait, hurry up and wait. And like, oh, now I go. And
yeah,
I can only, I'm trying to relate the frustration that this process can be to people who may not have been there before just to understand why. I mean, while it sounds like it's just signing documents, how bad could it be? But you don't I'm just trying to help them understand. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And it's important to emphasize that. I mean, a lot of people buying a home is the biggest financial transaction they have. It's incredibly emotional and stressful and meaningful in their lives. And to couple that with a negative experience, you know, while getting their mortgages, it's just not a good pairing. So the better you can make that experience and the better you can facilitate this like very important real world transaction, you know, the better off everybody's going to be.
So let me ask you the question that I know that I want answered, and I know the answer I want, but I'm sure you'll be realistic. So when can we get to this process of fully digital? Like, come on, man. You know, I'm just asking, you know, hey, let's make that happen.
Yeah, it's coming. If I had to guess, if I had to put money on it, I'd say maybe 3 years from now, the average consumer will be able to have a fully digital mortgage. There's a few reasons this is delayed, and there's a few reasons it's really complicated now. And it has to do with, the economic downturn and a lot of technology companies and a lot of sort of advancements in mortgage being slowed and installed in many cases. It has to do a lot with regulation. It has to do with the way these loans are bundled and sold, you know, after the mortgage company completes a transaction. So where you are seeing progress now on fully digital mortgages are places like local credit unions that are hanging on to their paper and not reselling the loan afterwards. Mm. So they don't have all of these kind of concerns and requirements. And so they're able to accept e-signatures and e-notes and e-notarizations. It's still a really small number of transactions, but it's a good place to start. And this is how a lot of technology gets developed, is you just find a place to get started and then push it forward. That will eventually spread. There's a lot of people that really want this to happen. It's just, you know, it's just a very complicated process. The way we think about it at Snapdocs is we're trying to think of what, you know, how can we improve the process in a way that every company can use today?
Right.
So where all of our loans still require wet signatures on paper documents, but what we can digitize is a lot of the decision-making, a lot of the reputation on, you know, the people you're working with, and automating a lot of the communication that happens around a mortgage loan closing. And people, you know, our customers that are using Snapdocs are really well prepared to plug into these notary cam options or these, you know, fully digital e-notes and e-notarizations. I think of it a little bit like Netflix. You know, when they started their company, they were mailing out DVDs.
Right.
They're a technology company. They were, you know, they had an online interface that people could order the movies. It was an improvement over Blockbuster. But it wasn't until the world was, you know, had high width bandwidth and, you know, computers that people wanted to watch movies on that they really became a fully technology company. And I think of Snapdocs in kind of similar terms.
Yeah, I think that's a very, very appropriate example. I do remember waiting for my Netflix DVD, too. Yeah. That was an important day. It's like, ooh, they're coming. So, you know, hey, that we started, that we would, like, camp out by the mailbox. So that was cool. Now, interestingly, though, because, you know, as you're talking, I'm like, I think about things like, you know, the iPad or specifically the iPad Pro and the Apple Pencil and how simple things are, like, you know, for documents that don't need a notary, et cetera, or wet signature. I signed those directly on my iPad right now. And I'm just like, man, if only it's like it feels like such one more small step for mankind, you know, that type of thing. It's like, can we just get this one more piece done? So let me ask you this. What can we do to help you guys in this mission? Because it benefits all of us. I mean, do we need to walk you guys in the door and say, hey, look, use these guys? What can we do? Because we're the ones processing or at least trying to buy the house, sell the house. We could probably help in some way.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a couple of things. I do think walking into the, you know, asking your title and escrow companies or any of your service providers what technology they're using and how they're improving the process through technology is a really important question. I think that really good brands are differentiating themselves by using the right tools like Snapdocs. I think part of it too has to do with coming to terms with, you know, how can we improve the process today instead of waiting for a future when there is an all digital mortgage. I think it's a matter of sort of implementing the building blocks that do exist today. Okay. So, you know, any sort of API integrations that these companies can be working with or any sort of incremental steps that they can be making. We, you know, we work really directly with title and escrow companies. I think real estate agents or real estate investors can be asking these companies kind of how are they finding their notary and what is their sort of roadmap for pushing towards a fully digital mortgage.
Got it. So do you guys have a solution to help people find notaries better?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a free, if you go to snapdocs.com, we have a free online directory of notaries, and you can even see if they've had a background check or if they have, you know, had some good experience on Snapdocs. So anybody can go to the website and find a notary if they need somebody. What we focus on right now really is high volume title companies. So big centralized companies that have a multi-state or nationwide footprint that are doing thousands of loan transactions a month. And really what Snapdocs is for them is we plug into their technology platform and we automate a lot of the process for finding a notary and managing that transaction.
You know, I like that. I mean, it's almost like I can order, let me see, in one day I should be able to order my Uber. I can order food with DoorDash, and then now I can order a notary at the same time. I kind of like it.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I don't ever, so you're just going to make sure I can stay at home. I never have to leave. That's pretty cool. Because it's one of the things that does annoy me, especially in the process. But still, interestingly enough, it doesn't stop us from buying property because we're still going to go out there and do it because it's like, that's how it's done. So when it comes down to like sourcing your notaries, do you have them everywhere? Like, or how does that
work? We do. So this is really interesting. A lot of your listeners might also be notary publics. If you are, I recommend signing up on snapdocs.com. You can register for a notary profile and upload your credentials and build a profile and get a lot of business. I mean, we have tons of notaries making six-figure incomes just doing loan closings through Snapdoc.
What?
So that could be a really good. I mean, yeah, absolutely. Notaries are getting, on average, you know, $75 to $110 per loan closing that they do. And Snapdocs is able to, you know, we know people's schedules and we know when they have other closings, we know what types of closings they do. And so we really optimize, you know, making sure the best notaries get a lot of work.
Wow.
And so notaries, you know, when they work hard and they give consumers a great experience, they end up getting a lot of business through the platform.
Wow. I think you might have just inspired somebody to go become a notary right there.
Yeah, absolutely. I got my notary license when I was 18. And I mean, it was a source of income, primary, if not secondary income for many, many years.
All right, then.
It can be a good business.
I'm used to paying it. I've never received money from it. Never thought, I've actually never even considered. I know you can make decent money as a notary, but now I guess so. Excellent in that way. So let me ask you this. Once you conquer the we'll call it, paperwork here and this whole process, what's next?
It's a great question. We really take things kind of one step at a time. Like I said, our business gets better as we do more transactions. We're doing, I think we did almost 60,000 mortgage transactions on the platform last month. So right now we're really trying to just get this in the hands of more people and really fix the loan closing process to the extent that our product does already. Some of the other things that we're working on are, like you said, you know, you can sign a lot of documents on an iPad or they don't need wet signatures. One thing we're interested in doing is helping our clients split out a set of loan documents into two distinct sets. One that you can just send for e-signature and one that the notary has to come out with.
Yes.
And you really don't see this happening very much today. And there's a few reasons for it. But, you know, especially as somebody who does a lot of these transactions, it'd be really convenient if you could just flip through and sign, you know, the 90 pages online, and then the notary comes out with 10 pages and you're done in 15 minutes.
Yes.
So that's one thing we're working on. And then the other thing we're trying to do is there's some pre-closing and post-closing kind of parts of the mortgage transaction that could benefit from some of the tools that we're doing. And so we're trying to just expand our offering a little bit to our current clients to help them, you know, help them schedule the appointment with the consumer, which strangely can be a pretty difficult and daunting task. And, you know, post-closing with the documents and checking for errors and making sure everything is correct at the closing instead of being corrected days later. A lot of these are sort of where we see development over the next couple of quarters.
Got it. Now, you've mentioned consumer a number of times. Will this also work for commercial transactions? I'm crossing my fingers right now.
They do, yeah. So we're pretty agnostic to the type of loan transactions on the platform. And so people are using Snapdocs for every type of, really any sort of loan transaction that requires a notary, people are using Snapdocs for.
Got it. But it's still going to be strictly US-based, yes?
Yeah, we don't have any, we've never even talked seriously about expanding beyond the US. We have plenty of work to do with this market before we do. Yeah.
No doubt. I gotta ask. Now, so for those that have listened this far and are probably genuinely interested in figuring out what you guys are up to and finding out more, what's going to be the best next step for them?
Best thing is to go to snapdocs.com. If you're at a title or escrow company, if you're a notary, or if you're interested in being a notary, there's information for sort of all the different people that can benefit from Snapdocs. So go there and peruse and get in touch if you have any questions at all. But that's probably the next best place to start.
Excellent. All right. So as we wind up here, I've got a question for you, and it'll be interesting to hear from your varied background to where you finally landed. Just your answer. So there's, because you know, like I know, you've run into these individuals, I'm sure, that there's a number of people listening, et cetera, or just in your circles who say things like, oh, that'd be cool one day if only I could. But maybe now they're beginning to go, you know what? They're standing in front of the superhero outfit store and going, you know, I'm going to do this thing. I'm going to be an entrepreneur. I'm going to be like Aaron. Yes, I'm going to make it happen. However, in the back of their mind, they, you know, they have that voice. And it's a voice I know that you have dealt with more than once, but you've managed to, you've got a process for dealing with it, and you've managed to overcome and continue to push forward. My question to you, though, is let's pretend that that person who thinks they're ready for this, you know, this challenge of being an entrepreneur, building their cash flow, et cetera, what would you say to them if you knew that they would actually follow through within the next 24 to 48 hours on what you told them to do?
Oh, man, I'd have a lot of advice for them. I'd say you don't have to bet the farm. You don't have to quit your job to start a company. There's a lot of work you can do in the meantime to sort of vet your ideas and your theories and, you know, make sure something actually has wheels before you take a huge risk on it. I see a lot of people, you know, quitting their jobs and starting a company, and sometimes startups or sometimes companies in general can take months or even years to really get off the ground. And you don't necessarily need to, you know, take a big financial hit to do that. That's probably the number one piece of advice I'd have is make sure something's working, or make sure you have some pretty good theories vetted before you take too big of a risk.
Yeah. Theories vetted, spoken like a veteran. It's like there's a story behind that one, at least one. So I can hear it completely. I definitely, though, want to say thanks for taking the time to invest your knowledge, your wisdom, your insight here with us at the Cashflow Diary. And please. Keep doing this. you will have a friend in me. That's what I've got to say for sure, Aaron, for sure.
All right. Thank you, Jay.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, you know what time it is. It's time for you to move at the speed of instruction. What does that mean? That means go over to snapdocs.com. That means if you're in the middle of a transaction, why not just give your title person a call and say, hey, have you heard of this? Because you know you're tired of the process and you'd like it to improve. And for those of you looking to get started, just make sure that your idea has some wheels. It's been fun talking to you guys today. I look forward to talking to you soon. Until next time.